Okay, Scott, it's time for the theme song.
Yeah, Shay. What do I do?
Let's see. I know. You can play this.
I don't want to play that. I'll look silly.
Oh, come on. It'll be fun.
Nope. Not gonna do it.
It's for the kids.
Oh, okay. But they better not laugh.
All right. Better get on out there.
If you thought you'd be at junior camp, going down the slip and slide, if you need a touch of God's love, and all you have done is sigh, have we got a show for you?
Splish splash, I was taking a bath, da-da-da, all on a Saturday night. Whoa, what was that? No way, there's only one thing that could be. What do you say we go check it out? Whoa, it is a whale, how cool. What do you guys say we play a little game of trivia about whales? Yeah? Okay, awesome. So I'll say a fact about whales and you have to guess if it's true or false. Ready? Question number one. Whales can hold their breath for at least 20 minutes. True or false? And the answer is true. Did you get it right? Let's try another one. A whale shoots seawater out of its blowhole. True or false? And the answer is false. Did you get this one wrong? I did too before I knew. Many people believe this, but it's actually a mixture of bacteria and hot air. How gross is that? Yeah, I know. Once it's exposed to a colder environment, the air condenses into water droplets. Let's do another one. Humpback whales sing complex songs. True or false? And the answer is true. Did you get that one right? Although the purpose isn't clear, I guess Dory was pretty right because they do emit a series of beautiful and complex sounds for several minutes.
We need
Dory.
To find
what are you doing?
The sun.
What are you doing? Are you sure you speak whale?
Let's try another one. During migration, whales are known to travel as far as 16,000 miles. True or false? And the answer is true. Did you get that one right? I bet you did. Let's try one more. There is a story about a great big fish, maybe even a whale, in the Bible. True or false? All right, now I know you got this one right. The answer is true. What do you say we go to the church and we check it out? Yeah, you with me? All right, let's go. Let's talk about a guy named Jonah. So the Lord came to him and he told him to go to Nineveh to preach because it was filled with wickedness and bad stuff. But you know what Jonah did? He ran away in the complete opposite direction and boarded up on a boat. So you know what God did? God came and he sent a great wind or a great storm. And the sailors with Jonah were freaking out. They were crying out to their own gods. And they were even throwing stuff off the ship to make the ship lighter so that it wouldn't be able to be rocked by the waves as much. You know where Jonah was? Jonah was sleeping. So one of the sailors went down to the area where Jonah was sleeping. They woke him up and said, "How can you be asleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he will take notice of us so that we will not perish." They started talking and they figured out that Jonah had ran from God and that he was the one to blame for the storm. So Jonah told them, "Say, hey, take me, throw me into the sea, and then, only then, the storm would stop." So that's what they did. They took Jonah and they threw him overboard. Then the Lord sent a huge fish. It doesn't say what kind of fish, but it says a huge fish, and that he was swallowed, and Jonah sat in the belly of this fish for 3 days and three nights. Can you imagine being stuck all alone inside the belly of a fish for that long? 3 whole days. Now, when Jonah was inside this fish, you could imagine he was probably pretty scared. So you know what he did? He prayed to God. And he prayed this exact prayer that we're going to read. So if you're following along, grab your Bibles, flip to Jonah 2. Jonah 2. And if you need to, you can pause the video, find it, and then pick it right back up. "In my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me. From the deep of the realm of the dead, I called for help, and you listened to my cry. You hurled me into the depths, into the very heart of the seas, and the currents swirled about me. All your waves and breakers swept over me. I said, 'I have been banished from your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple.' The engulfing waters threatened me. The deep surrounded me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. To the roots of the mountains I sank down. The earth beneath barred me in forever. But you, Lord, my God, brought my life up from the pit. When my life was ebbing away, I remembered you, Lord, and my prayer rose to you, to your holy temple. Those who cling to worthless idols turn away from God's love for them. But I, with shouts of grateful praise, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will make good. I will say, 'Salvation comes from the Lord.' And the Lord commanded the fish, and it vomited Jonah into the dry land. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, 'Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim it to the message I give you.'" So Jonah's in the belly of this fish and he just got finished praying this prayer. And you know what happened? If we keep on reading in the last verse of Jonah 2, we see that the Lord commanded the fish and it vomited Jonah onto the dry land. So this fish basically threw up and Jonah was in there and he landed on the beach. How crazy is that? But that's not all that we should take note of here. It said that the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. So God's up there looking like, "Hey man, I really need you to go to Nineveh. You know, you really need to do this." Now, after being through this experience, you know what Jonah did? He got up and he went to Nineveh to preach. You know, when we find ourselves in a dark place, when we feel surrounded, when we feel lonely, one thing that we can always do is call on the name of the Lord our God. That's part of prayer. 2 Chronicles 7 and 14 says, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear them from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land." You see, we're quick to pray to God when it feels like things aren't going our way, when we're angry or sad or depressed, or even if we feel like we're in the belly of a big fish. But going deeper in our relationship with God doesn't mean that we should just pray to Him in the bad times. Ephesians 6 and 18 says, "And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people." So we should pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. You see, prayer isn't just about asking for help. It's about developing a relationship with God. Let me introduce to you Chad. Chad, come on out here.
What's up, buddy?
Oh, not much. Chad is someone I would consider a best friend. You see, I don't just talk to Chad when I want to complain about being grounded or having to do extra chores or having all the problems that I'm going through. Sure, we do talk about those things, but if that's all that we were to talk about, he might get a little annoyed because that's all I ever talk about. So a friendship and a relationship with God is much, much more than that. Like me and Chad, you know, we talk about what we've done, cool places we've been.
New shows we watch on Netflix.
Sharing our new favorite songs.
Congratulations on our accomplishments.
Yeah, we talk about Chad's girlfriend.
Well, you know, Scott's lack of a girlfriend.
Hey, well, I mean, yeah, you're right. I think you get the point, though. A relationship is more than just complaining and griping and asking for things. A relationship is getting to know one another and not just doing it at just church or just at camp.
We could FaceTime, text, or call each other. Or maybe it's on the playground while we're playing a game and having fun. Or maybe it's just riding around in a car and listening to music. We can develop a relationship at school by telling a funny story. Or if you're anything like me and Chad, you really enjoy hanging out at the Mexican restaurant.
You see, a relationship is built upon you spending time with and communicating with another person. Prayer is the main way that we communicate with God, kind of like talking on the phone or sending a text message. But how do we pray to God? You know, our Bible says something, so let's open up our Bibles to see what it says. If you have your Bible with you, you can turn with me to Matthew 6, and we're looking for verses 9 through 13. And we're reading out of the NIV version today, so yours may be just a little bit different. But I've got some people that are going to help me with this passage. Verse 9 says, "This then is how you should pray.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done.
On earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from the evil one.
For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Amen."
You see, the Bible tells us exactly how to pray, but you don't have to recite this prayer word for word every time. Remember to think about your friends. You know, you don't tell them the same thing over and over. God wants you to speak from your heart. So let's see how we can use the Lord's Prayer, which is in the Bible, to pray in our own way by hearing how some of our staff pray to God.
God, we love you today. We give you praise and glory for all that you are.
God, fill my life with your presence and lead me to what you will have me do with what is in your will.
Lord, I thank you that you give us exactly what we need for the day. You give us the word and spirit that takes us through the day and helps us in every way that we need.
I ask for forgiveness, Lord, of times maybe I've not done what you wanted me to do, God. And Father, or maybe I have messed up, but you have forgiven me because I've asked for forgiveness.
And God, keep me away from the things that make me want to do wrong. Keep me away from temptation that makes me want to be around wrong situations and wrong things. Help protect me from that, Lord.
I just want to thank you and praise you for all things that you do for me, God.
Amen. Remember that the Lord's Prayer is a good general outline to help you pray. But what's really important is speaking to God from your heart and developing that relationship with Him. Now, Matthew 6 also gives us some other instructions on how to pray. In the 6th verse, it says, "Go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father." You see, when we pray, God doesn't want us to do it because we want others to see us praying. He even says in verse 5 not to be like the hypocrites. So don't be like the hypocrites who love to pray standing in the streets to be seen by others. We should pray to God because we want to develop our relationship with God, not because we have to validate our Christianity to others. Another thing found in verses 7 and 8 tells us not to babble. You don't have to say a whole lot of words to be heard by God, for our Father knows what we need before we even ask Him. The last thing found in verses 14 and 15 is probably the hardest part of prayer. It says to forgive other people when they sin against you, because if we don't forgive others of their sins, why should God forgive us of ours? God calls us to love everybody, even those who wrong us, but we need to forgive them and also pray for them because we are called to love as God loves us. What's really cool is that we can pray to God anywhere. In our bedroom, in the car, in the park, in the pool, at school, in your closet, which is a great place to find a quiet place with God, or even in the shower. And you can talk to Him at any time of the day or the night. The Bible says in 1 John 5 and 14 that if we have confidence when we pray to God, that if we ask anything according to His will, He will hear us. How cool is it that God hears us when we pray to Him? Pretty neat, huh? So let's talk about what we've learned today. Today,
we see, we know that God's word is for everyone. And now that our song is done, we'll take a look.
Today, we learned about going deeper in our relationship with God. We heard the story of how Jonah prayed when he was in a fishy situation. We learned how to pray by using the Lord's Prayer, and we discussed other important things to do when praying. Let's see if Cordy has another verse for us today. Jeremiah 29 and 12. Let's read this one together. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. Jeremiah 29, 12. God loves us very much, and He wants us to develop a relationship with Him. But before we can do that, we must go deeper in prayer with Him and share our request, our thanks, and forgive others and pray for our enemies. So what do you say we go together in prayer right now?
God, I just want to come to You today and thank You for the relationship that we are able to have with You. I know that through prayer, we can go deeper in our relationship with You, God, and that we don't just have to pray to You in the bad times. Lord, I want to share my accomplishments with You. I want to share the words that You give me, dear God, and I want to praise You and I want to thank You. And I know that I can do that through prayer at any day and any time. Lord, we praise You and we thank You for Your holy name. Lord, we thank You for giving us the Lord's Prayer to be able to understand and to know how to pray to You, dear God. But Lord, most of all, we thank You for who You are and what You've done and what You are going to continue to do in our lives as we go deeper in a relationship with You. In Your holy name I pray. Amen. Today I want you to find someone to pray with. Find a family member, call your best friend, FaceTime your grandma, whoever. Ask them for their prayer request, and then also be sure to tell them yours. And remember to offer praise, give thanks, and most importantly, speak from your heart. We say we pray, Chad, before you eat.
There it is.
Hey, all the world starts crying when the church starts.